You're still watching The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and today we are delighted to be hosting the Executive Director of the National NGO Bureau, Mr. Stephen Okello. And we are talking about regulation of the NGO world in Uganda. Stephen, before we went for a break, you had tried to explain to us the process within which NGOs are registered, what they need to comply, the difference between private organizations and other. When you look at the law, as a person that has been here for 16 years, are you comfortable? Can you comfortably say that all these processes and the law, the NGOs that are operating out there, leave the confines of Kampala, go deep down in Amudat, go to my place in Kalisizo, the NGOs that are operating within those spaces, are they aware of these laws and the processes that they are supposed to follow if they are to comply within the laws of the land that allow them to operate?
Yes, thank you, Nicholas. These are laws of the country, meaning that after they went through cabinet and went through parliament, and then the president assented to it, final step was a gazetting, meaning that all these instruments that we are now enforcing are gazetted documents, meaning that from that date they are gazetted, they are now documents that the sector and even the general should know are out there operating. Because and that's why they end up saying that ignorance of the law is no defense at the end of the day. However much you say, people, I did not know about this provision. But you see, we also take that into consideration, that there are people who may not know about this. And that's why we have exercises we carry out. We have dissemination exercises. We go on radio talk shows countrywide. We have reflection meetings. I'll tell you that, go around the country. There's no district I've not gone to. I walk there with my team, sit with district officials, sit with NGO representatives. We discuss. We tell them the new regulatory framework for NGOs is this. And you see, at times also, there are those that are incidental, that they're not even aware of. I'll give you an example, like the Anti-Money Laundering Act. So many NGOs, you realize out there, are ignorant of it. And that means that the moment we go out, we don't only focus on the NGO Act, we also focus on those ones that are key, because NGOs are accountable persons under the Anti-Money Laundering Act. And therefore, if you don't let them know, they are going to fall into trouble at the end of the day. So we extensively go around the country, disseminate and build capacity of all the stakeholders. Therefore, at the end of the day, anyone who fails to comply, ignorance of the law is no defense, and we have done our part to really ensure NGOs out there all know what the law is and the content. But of course, also another thing that also is affecting so many organizations is the poor reading culture. You can't blame the Bureau for a poor reading culture. We go out, we distribute these documents. These documents on the website, you just have to open and you read. But do people read them? They don't. I'll tell you that it's not only the NGO Act that is gazetted. You may forgive them for that it was gazetted. NGOs don't even read their own internal governing documents. We handle complaints, we investigate issues, we summon organizations, we hold meetings. We try to verify things in their own internal governing document, and they don't have a clue. They're telling you, when we were starting, we had a lawyer or we hired someone to do the work for us. When the person was done, it was registered, we started operating and all. What they're doing out there, it's not matching what is in their own internal governing document. Now, it's not the responsibility of the Bureau to make them read. We shall tell them, okay, try and read, but can people also promote the reading culture? Yes.
You said if any of these organizations is aggrieved, they can come to you. In a war of an appeal, how is this going to be possible when you do not have an adjudication committee that is provided for in the law? But in addition to that, you These are policy decisions that you're making. Without a policy organ, you don't have an NGO board. So where do your activities stem from? I would say you're carrying out an exercise in futility, because tomorrow you're going to be challenged. You're operating under no law, because my assumption is that the NGO Bureau is a fully constituted body that must have the NGO board, the secretariat, which you head as executive director or CEO, and then an adjudication committee.
You see, Nicholas, you're raising two issues. One's about a board and its functions. The other one is about the adjudication committee. Let me start with the one of the board. You are stating that what we are doing, our decisions, are policy issues. No. These are technical issues. These are administrative functions. And I want to really set also the record straight that the board that we had in place from 1989 up to 2016, on the 14th of March 2016, when the NGO Act really started, was an executive board. It did technical work. It was the one that registered NGOs as a board. It was the one that monitored, and they would go physically. It was the one that inspected. It's the one that did all the technical work. That was their work. The board we have now, you need to read Section 11. It's a policy and oversight board. It means that it gives us the guidance and direction. We go and implement. Every quarter we go back and report to the board and tell the board that this is what you told us to do this financial year. For quarter one, we are back to report. This is what we have done. And they are the ones overseeing what we do. But it's not that the board is coming to do the actual technical work. No. Yes. Mm-hmm. Because you said these are policy decisions. These are not policy decisions. These are technical decisions. Now, I want you to also read Section 5.
But the technical decisions emanate from the policy decisions, right?
These are legal obligations.
Yes.
These are legal obligations under law. There are legal obligations that are saying if you don't have a valid pipe, do not operate. It says that you must submit your annual return. It's not even allowing you choose whether you can submit or not. It's conditional.
So you're saying the Bureau can stand without the role of the board.
I'm coming to that. And so what I'm trying to say is that you said currently there's no board. But you see, this law commenced on the 14th of March 2016, meaning that there's been a board until 4th September 2020, when their term expired, and the minister is already in the process of finalizing and putting a board in place. Now, if what we are discussing was for the period between 14th March 2016 and now, then you'd have a valid point. You'd say you have never had a board and what, but a board was in place. And it did its work, there are strategic plans in place, and the Bureau is following that. Now, let people not take advantage of the vacuum of this period when a board is not there to say that the NGO Bureau should not be doing anything. Because if you read Section 5 of the Act, it establishes a semi-autonomous entity that has capacity and functions to do some things. That's why we fall. We are in the same autonomous entity doing its work. The board is supposed to be giving policy and oversight things. It means we cannot stop our operations and close up just because the board is not there. We have to continue operating. But also in addition to that, the decisions we took are not the only decisions we take. We register NGOs. From 4th September, when the term of the board expired, to now, we are still registering NGOs. We are still renewing NGOs. We are recommending NGOs to other entities. Has anyone ever come? Have NGOs ever said, you people, without a board now, why are you renewing our permit? No one is talking about the registration function. Why are they only talking about the other functions we're exercising in relation to their renewal, in relation to whether they are complying or not? These are all the same. The technical team we have in place is competent, and they're doing it within the powers that they're given to transact. So when the board is finally constituted, we are going to present all these reports to them. We are going to say that, board, while you are away, from 4th September up to now, the following happened. They are going to receive reports, because even if we investigate these NGOs, it's not for the board to do that. They are going to receive the reports. We shall discuss them and what. So for them, they are waiting for our reports. Then the second issue you raise is on the adjudication committee. That the impression is like the NGOs are trapped without an appeals body. Now, the adjudication committee is a new creation. Originally, between 1989 up to 2016, any NGO that was aggrieved could appeal to the Minister of Internal Affairs. And NGOs over the period complained that, no, why are we appealing to the Minister of Internal Affairs? Is he going to be fair because you're under them? Is going to be... So when this law was being repealed, we created what was called the NGO Adjudication Committee. Now, at the beginning of this year, sometime in March, an NGO Adjudication Committee procedure rules was also actually gazetted. So the rules are in place in terms of their procedure. The only thing left is the adjudication committee. But just like I've explained for the board, the absence of an adjudication committee does not mean that there is a vacuum that now cannot be addressed. As we talk now, anyone who feels aggrieved with any of our decisions is still free to go to the High Court. Because even after the adjudication committee, you are free to go to the High Court. And I can give you examples that October?
As you're going to give me that example, yes. I wanted you to highlight the notion that the way the law is framed, you cannot, yes, you can go to the High Court, but you cannot go to the High Court without the first case of incidents is the adjudication committee.
Yes, yes, I agree.
Is adjudication committee, so without it,
and no.
You say they are trapped.
Nicholas, I want to really correct this. That this is government. Because either an individual or an office is not there doesn't mean there's now a state of blockage that no one can go past that. Between 2016 in March up to now, when this new law came in force, how many NGOs have gone to court over this, over different issues? There are many. We have so many court cases, so many instances, and we go and engage them over it. No one is stopped from going to court, regardless of your capacity. That's why all NGOs are incorporated. The Bureau is a autonomous entity. You can sue it. So at the end of the day, you don't have to necessarily wait. Why did we create an adjudication committee? We created it because angels over the years go to court for so many reasons. Other people sue them, not even the Bureau. People sue them, people arrest individuals there for different reasons. What we have always wanted is that angels don't have money to start spending on legal issues, yet they're out there looking for resources to help beneficiaries. Now, we want to create this adjudication committee that you start with it. It's an independent body. The person chairing it is not from the Bureau. It's an independent body that saves NGOs that cost of us going to the High Court. But as long as it's not there, you are free to still proceed. I will give you incidences. In October last year, there was an organization called the National Election Watch. We took some decisions against it. It ran to court. And there are so many others. You see, not everyone will be happy with your decisions. And you have to respect
But then, in all fairness, would it be fair that because many of them are complaining, that you've suspended their activities without necessarily giving them a fair hearing?
Three options are actually given to them. I've told you, first one, that is the cheapest, come back to us and tell us, you people. By the way, we already have even others who are writing to apologize and say, the Bureau, yes, we are sorry, we did not do this. Please, what is the way forward? They are coming. There are those who are saying, okay, how did you reach this? Can you guide us on this? We're also going to sit down and discuss with them. The other one I've told you, court. But you see, in the absence of whether a board or adjudication committee, the ministry leadership is still there. there's a minister, there are two ministers in office, there's a permanent secretary, whom we are still working closely with them and we are engaging them. So at the end of the day, there's no vacuum. We still have the political leadership, we have the chief executive who is the permanent secretary, and therefore we can still engage and have anyone even go and meet them to discuss. So there's nothing that we should have the impression that the board is not there, adjudication committee is not yet formed, so angels are in a fix. There's no fix that they're in, they can still get a way out.
Yes. Don't you think you're doing the country a disservice in the face of COVID-19 that you're closing 54 NGOs that have been employing hundreds of probably would-be unemployed young people?
Yes, I understand the concern you are raising, because you see, you don't have to then blame the bureau. Why don't you blame the organization? Because you see, for me actually, if I was an NGO and something like this happened, instead of becoming defensive and instead of trying to say this is the bureau's fault, government is using the bureau to witch hunt us, what I would do, I would have an in-house self-reflection to find out why did we fail to submit returns for 4 or 5 years. Who let us down in this office? Why haven't we renewed our documents for 3 years? That is what angels should be tasking themselves internally. Now, if you think it is all about how you can become defensive, then you miss the point. The moment someone tells you there are legal obligations in this country and you have not complied, can you first go and look internally? Because to me, actually, by the way, I would be interested in who in your organization is in charge of applying for this. I don't think it is the board. The ED may have interest, but I don't think it's the ED's work. There is someone in the office who has that as a responsibility. Then in addition to that, returns. It's an obligation. It's not like a discretion you decide. That means people must comply. I will tell you that NGOs report to whoever funds them, the donors who give them money. They also report to internally their boards. Then they also report to the general public through the bureau. But NGOs are so prompt in reporting to the development partners. Why can't they do the same to the regulator? Because you see, the regulator is acting on behalf of the general public, that we need to know what are you doing out there. So report. So for me, instead of being defensive and saying they're witch hunting us, it's political, it's human rights, is this, there's nothing like that. This is an opportunity for any NGO to go and think internally. Where did we go wrong? How comes our permit expired for all this period? Who was responsible for that? That's what boards should be grilling their EDs and their staff, not running and trying to blame the bureau. Yes.
If it is not a witch hunt, like you say, why concentrate on these 54, which many of them, okay, no, the bulk, a significant number are human rights related activists, and yet you have NGOs out there in the countryside that do not regard district authorities, that replicate work that should be done by the government. They are always on the run, clashing with the local governments. How far do you stretch in terms of scope when it comes to regulating NGOs in the country?
Yes, our scope is countrywide. It's not only restricted to a specific area. And I can tell you, go and check the addresses of all these organizations. They're not only in Kampala. Actually, a greater majority are out there. And even on top of that, I want you to go and get the percentage of the human rights organization. It's very small. The bigger ones are actually, others are faith-based organizations, others are youth organizations, others are actually different categories. So it means that there's no interest in a particular one. It is a cut-across compliance issue that is the flow that we are handling now. But do not say that because you are handling this now, then the others that are not there at the sidelines that will go, their time is coming. Because you see, at the end of the day, that is what is showing us, according to the record. Between Friday, the other week, on the 20th of this month, between then and now, How many organizations are having their permits expired between that time? They're still there. Are we going to also sit back and look at? No. Meaning that for us, this is our normal administrative routine work we do. That means that by the end of this month, even by next week or this week, the M&E department, the inspector, is going to give more reports and say that, okay, at first it was 54. Now even another 100 has fallen victim. Yeah, another thing. So at the end of the day, the burden is on the Ugandan people who must remain compliant, the NGOs. For us, we are doing our normal work. So even right now as we talk, someone's permit is expiring. Someone is falling within the docket of failing to comply with the returns and filing returns. So it's not like either you are saying, okay, the 54 enough. No, the 54 are just part of what we do normally. For now, that was what was according to our records. But as we go on, those who are not compliant will still keep coming to the arena.
Yes. Do you have capacity to enforce compliance? When I understand when you interface with the Defence and Internal Affairs Committee in Parliament,
yes.
you understaffed your low the financing is very low. Do you have capacity? Because that goes down to, well, you don't have capacity, so you continue operating within Kampala, and because those that you're basically interested in are within the Kampala scope, so you're comfortable being there around.
You see, Nicholas, every government, ministry, department, and agency has its challenges. And you'll see that top on the list are funding challenges. The Bureau may have its challenges, but does that mean it should lay down its tools? Does it mean that now NGOs should take advantage of that and say, okay, now the regulator is having funding challenges, we can relax? The answer is no. We are still going to continue doing our work. And the way the law is now, we have so many stakeholders on board. We have the district NGO monitoring committees, we have the sub-county NGO monitoring committees, we have all these line ministries that are in place, and we have all these structures that can be used to check compliance. I don't have to be physically in Edambale to find out whether someone's compliant or not. Someone there will find out and let me know. Someone there will engage our team here and say, I'm in Bale, so and so is doing ABCD, is not registered with you, is doing ABCD and what. So at the end of the day, it is not about the challenges. Challenges are there. Government is trying to address them. But at the end of the day, it comes back to the element of, is the Bureau doing its work? Whether we are understaffed, whether we are inadequately resourced, we are still doing our work, and we shall keep doing it as government addresses the challenges.
Don't you think that the time is now to start thinking about a conversation of self-regulation for these NGOs? Well, without necessarily taking away your mandate, but I mean, we have the law council, but law society does self-regulation for the law fraternity. So don't you think that would help if these NGOs did self-regulation to fill the gap where you might not be able to reach?
You see, Nicholas, self-regulation is what the NGO Act has even requested the NGOs to do. That, you see, don't wait for the regulator from government to come and see if you're compliant or not. Can NGOs out there put themselves together and self-regulate themselves? Not like you put yourself away from the authority of government. No, you do not. But you check yourselves. You say, okay, assuming we are in a group of 100 NGOs, can we check ourselves? Do we all have valid permits as we sit here as this one team? Then you help each other. Are we being compliant? Are we filing returns or not? So self-regulation is what we would really promote. You see, at first, before 2016, it was not a requirement in the law. Now, with the new Act 2016, we have given a full blessing that you are free to self-regulate. Can you come up with self-regulatory mechanisms? Can you really even have a code of conduct? Can you just put together? Then let us know that this organization called Nicholas Foundation is a self-regulatory body. that has the following members who have consented to be a part of it, and they have the following self-regulatory mechanism in place. The members have consented at this. You submit to us and let us know. So in terms of self-regulation, the government has really given them a head and is pushing for them. I'm aware that the NGO Forum and Deniva came together and formed a self-regulatory body. And occasionally, when they even award some of these organizations, they invite us. They have a self-regulatory mechanism called QAM. They invite us. We go and witness their awards. And that is the way to go. That internally, self-regulate yourselves so that by the time the regulator is coming on board, you're already compliant. So this is an opportunity for NGOs to start that discussion internally. That's why I said it's not about being defensive. Can angels now start checking themselves? Individual angels check yourselves, but the sector also check yourselves. Can you now say, okay, can we now be able to see, okay, how can we benefit from self-regulatory bodies? You see, if you have your own internal compliance checklists as a self-regulatory body, you save yourself such incidences. Because at the end of the day, you want to start saving face because you say, my name can't appear there. How, who put me there? Me, I'm not. Yet the Bureau is saying you are not compliant. Yes.
Don't you think it would be prudent if you're interested in this very pertinent sector, that it runs smoothly, it would be prudent for you? Yes, you said you're now on the receiving book end. You're saying we've given you a go-ahead to self-regulate, so you're waiting for them to come. Wouldn't be prudent for you to go out and help the sector be able to organize themselves into a self-regulating entity so that it eases your work as well?
You see, one thing is that much as we are the regulator of NGOs, I already told you earlier, we disseminate, we build capacity countrywide, we have reflection meetings, we do a lot out there with the NGOs in order to have them on board. However, you see, there are things that are initiated internally. Mm. We cannot dictate. We cannot say, you. Now, we cannot, because you see, we shall be unfair. And that's not what the government is about. That we start saying now, can the NGOs internally initiate such self-regulatory bodies? Because you see, what is happening now should even be the basis now to make a case out there. That because we are not self-regulating ourselves, see what is happening. People are now failing to be compliant, and therefore they have to really form these regulatory self-regulatory bodies. So for the Bureau to go and start dictating that you, 100 angels on our register in this area, go and self-regulate, no, we shall be crossing a line, yes.
You'll be crossing the line. Yes. Don't you fear that some of these your activities are a disservice to the public that is supposed to feel service delivery in the absence of government? And I think the reason as to why the emergence of civil society and NGO work starts from 1989, when there's virtually no government. So this space that they have been feeling, who is going to fill that space if you continue pushing and showing these NGOs?
You see, Nicholas, you sound like the 54 NGOs at the end of all NGOs in this country. No, the NGOs operating, even as we talk now in this interview, you don't know how many are actually registering now. More coming up every day to register. What is happening here is that government appreciates the complementary role that NGOs plays. It doesn't mean that because either there are sanctions against some, then government is insensitive, then it appreciates. Government appreciates. It is employing Ugandans, it's paying taxes, it is doing lots. It has beneficiaries, orphans, it's opening schools, constructing boreholes, it's doing a lot. Now, what is happening here is that because you play a complementary role, it does not mean you are taking away the legal obligations. Actually, it even now lifts the bar higher. It even makes the bar go high. The fact that you're bringing funds into the country, you have beneficiaries who are relying on you, whom you're giving hope. someone has to check what you're doing, and that's where the regulator is. And therefore, at the end of the day, we appreciate the complementary role, but can people remain compliant with whatever they're doing?
As we step out, there is this feeling that as a regulator, you largely operate on orders from above. The state does not feel that NGO X does not warrant to operate within the spaces of Uganda, then that will be clamped upon and then lampooned with all the others that are non-compliant.
Nicholas, I had actually indicated earlier that defensive mechanism should stop, whereby because now you are non-compliant, you want to drag the president into it, you want to drag politics into it, you want to drag a witch hunt into it. But is anyone who is saying that coming out to say, you see, I'm actually compliant, I have a valid permit, it's here? If that was the discussion and saying, I saw you are saying that I'm non-compliant, yet I have a valid permit, maybe it is either someone witch hunting me, that becomes a different discussion. But if I have an expired permit, but I'm there saying, I think the president is after me, it's political, it's a witch hunt, then
maybe
you miss the point.
Maybe some of these even fear to come for their permits, because by and large, they know the moment they flash themselves as having an invalid permit,
you see, they
are going to be naked.
You see, what the Bureau does is technical. We are enforcers of a law, and we are doing our work, and we're ensuring that whoever is not compliant has to be really brought on board immediately. So it's not about being after someone, because you see, at the end of the day, compliance issues should not be mixed with either political issues. It's strictly compliance. So I want to set the record straight. The Bureau is doing its work. It has its mandate under the NGO Act, and it is doing it. And at the end of the day, I told you, we are protecting the beneficiaries, and it's about the country as a whole. So it's not about that we are after an NGO. No, we are after no organization. We are doing our work, yes.
Of course, you continue insisting that you're after no organization. But I mean, there is precedent to this. If NGO X has time and again been touched with the state, and the state has been speaking out against it, and then months down the road, you come up to say that this entity is non-compliant, definitely the interpretation is going to be that you are against that NGO.
You see, I've told you.
Public perception is very important.
I've told you, and that's why you're helping us set the record straight. Ours is strictly technical and enforcing the law. So we are not saying, you see, if there's a coincidence that Nicholas Foundation has been doing this with the government and has fallen victim to this, is it true that actually it has fallen victim to a compliance issue? If yes, for us it stops there. It's not like someone has given you orders to know. It's strictly compliance. And that's why I said, go and check the 54 NGOs. Are they all human rights organizations? Are they all the ones that engage? The answer is no. That's why falling in there doesn't mean someone is after you.
Yes. So I mean, if you're saying that they are not, there is a possibility that the 54 are all known NGOs, then it goes back to the original conversation.
No, I've said there's no witch hunt, and let no one drag the government and political things into this. Yes.
But your parting shot, Stephen?
My parting shot is to call upon all NGOs to really remain compliant. There's an Act of Parliament in place. No one is above the law, and we should really stick and follow the law strictly. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephen, for making time for the show. Be sure to catch the checkpoint same time next week. Good night.